Welcome back to a series of videos called Lost Wolfe Notes, in which I record, teach you how to, or not teach you, give you ideas for how to record your computer games and so on. We've left this alone for about 2 months, and now I've got a little bit of a break in the schedule, so I want to do one of these. Next up on the topic list, we had your computer and your hardware. So, let's talk about that very quickly. I want to talk, for those of you who don't know anything about a computer, I want to talk a little bit about what a PC is and how it works. So we're going to talk about, not necessarily how it works, but what the anatomy of a PC is, because there are a couple of things that you need to bear in mind when you go out and you decide that you're going to start recording your games. They're going to be pieces that you're absolutely going to want to get, then they're going to be pieces that you want to have that are nice to have. And so we need to talk about what components are in your actual computer. The next thing we need to discuss along the way, these two topics go hand in hand, is the considerations for what you are going to record, because that is almost always going to drive how much money you're going to spend. Then we're going to talk about the hardware that you absolutely, definitely need to begin with. After that, you can buy whatever else is on your shopping list, but these are the core components of your computer that you must buy in order to record. Then we got nice to haves, things that are great, that will help you, but that don't necessarily need to be on your initial shopping list. I'm going to talk a little bit about the microphone and headset debate, and where I fall with that. We're going to talk a little bit about your timer, because your timer is an extra thing that you're going to want to have, and console recording, which I'm only going to briefly touch on because I don't do a lot of it. So, the anatomy of a PC. Your PC contains many parts. The two main things you need to bear in mind is that there are things that you can see on your computer and things that are invisible, things that you can't see, but you do need. So for the visible pieces of your PC, we have the keyboard. Keyboards come in many shapes and sizes. The most common Western layout is QWERTY, and you're probably going to buy a QWERTY keyboard. What does that mean? It means that the upper left-hand corner of the keyboard says QWERTY in that straight line. So if you typed it out, that would be what you would get. The other kind of layout is Dvorak, which they use a lot of it in like the European countries. It makes typing for those languages a little bit easier than English. It's also, some people find it more comfortable. But you need to experiment. If you are going to do any adventure games and you're going to type a lot, you're going to need to do some experimentation and find out which one works for you. Most people will use QWERTY. Most people listening to me now will use QWERTY. The thing that you need to bear in mind with the keyboard is it sturdy? In other words, when you put your hands on it, does it move? You don't want any of that happening. You don't want it to, if you've got it on stands like I am, I'm on slightly high stand, because most keyboards have got little feet and you can tip them upward. You don't want to be able to press those feet down in the middle of a recording and have it slam down and make a noise, that kind of thing. Does it have a palm rest? Remember, you're going to be, if you're going to be doing this and you're going to be playing especially adventure games where you type, you're going to need to be comfortable, and the palm rest will help you be comfortable. With a mouse, a lot of people say that if you're going to do recordings of your games, you need a gaming mouse. Now, I don't think that's necessarily true. If you like gaming mice and you've been using a gaming mouse and you're happy with a gaming mouse, go ahead, be my guest. But in the, I want to say almost 25 years or so that mice have been available, I've never bought a gaming mouse. But that's just because my needs are different to most people's needs. I don't really play competitive shooters. I don't really do any of those things. For me, a normal regular mouse will suffice. You need to do your homework about this. But I think that for most people in this situation who want to do recording, they will probably not need a gaming mouse. So don't run off, spend the money, and worry about it too much. The other thing is to make sure that it's comfortable. Remember that if you're going to be playing games on a computer and you're going to be recording them, you're going to be doing it for a long time. Like, my minimum session is the actual gameplay, which is probably between kind of 10 and minutes and half an hour for most videos, and then after that I am editing and uploading, and editing will roughly take like about an hour, hour and a half, depending on what's going on with the video. If it's very labor intense, it might take a little bit longer than that, say up to 3 hours or so. And then you're going to be uploading. And while you're busy editing, you're going to be using the mouse a lot. So you need to make sure that the mouse is comfortable. The other thing that is visible that you can see outside is a chassis. They call this a case sometimes when they're referring to it. I'm going to tell you now, the softer your case is, the better off it's going to be for you. So if you can buy, I haven't put it on this particular slide, and I should have maybe put it on, but the two cases I bought in the last 8 years that have been very silent are the Fractal Define R4, which is a very good, very big, spacious case, and it has lots of sound dampening on it, so it isn't loud at all. And the other thing I bought was the Antec Solo. I loved the Solo. It was just a little bit quiet, and they don't make the version of, it was a little bit small, and they don't make the Solo that I bought initially, and I haven't really liked the new Solos. So the other thing I'm going to suggest that you look for when you're buying a chassis is make sure that the USB ports are in the front, not at the back. And the reason why I say that is because generally what you want to do is you're going to plug in extra things in the front. Like if you've got a headphone set that is USB, make sure that the USB is in the front, because it will give you a little bit more slack. And also because that way you can always pull it out and move the headphones and microphone wherever you want them to be on another computer if you have to in a hurry. Also, you're going to probably plug your controller in, and it makes more sense to have them in the front. For the monitor, I'm going to say that if you have the money, buy two. But if you don't have the money, find yourself a smaller second device or screen. Why? Because you're going to, if you're playing adventure games particularly, you're going to want to have the walkthrough somewhere near you if that's how you're going to be playing it, or your notes if that's how you're going to be playing it. And you're going to want that on a separate screen so you can just glance at it. I tend to write things down on paper, so people who watch me regularly will hear the rustling of paper every now and then. I'm just more comfortable with paper. Also, the desk I have is very, very small, so it wouldn't support a second monitor. And I haven't really ever bothered with a second device. So I'm trampling on my own advice here, but the point is that you're going to want a second way to look at your guide if you're using a guide. Also, this will help you for those of you who are going to bridge across and do streaming. If you're going to bridge across and do streaming, eventually you're going to want a second monitor for your conversation with your audience. So I would highly advise getting a second screen of some persuasion. But again, don't break the bank. You know, we're talking about, it doesn't need to be as good as your first monitor, your original monitor. It just has to be good enough to display things. Okay, so now that's the outside. That's what you can see and touch. The things that are inside of your PC are a little different because you can't touch them. Sometimes you can see them because they're going to have ports at the back, especially for the first couple of things I'm talking about. With a sound card, at this point, you know what? It doesn't matter. Don't go off and buy a separate sound card. Unless you're producing high fidelity recordings, it won't make a difference to you. Onboard sound, go for it. What I mean by onboard sound is that some computers come with a central processing unit, which we'll talk about in a minute or so, and they will have a couple of things that are added on. One of the things they might have is sound. Don't even worry about a sound card. You will be okay with whatever you have on your actual CPU. Your video card is a very big discussion, and a discussion I'm not really going to have yet. But what I suggest that you think about when you're talking about recording your games is thinking about the age of the game, okay? Because the video card that you buy is going to be somewhat dependent on the games that you decide to play. Newer games require better video cards. If you're gonna, like, this video is being made in April of 2016, and if you had to start recording, say, The Division now, or if you had to start, say, recording Tomb Raider now, you would probably want a top-of-the-line video card to max out the settings so it looked good, so people aren't just looking at a terrible low-resolution screen. So it's very game-dependent. I record a lot of old games. For me, the video card is almost a non-factor. But remember that your video card, in this case, is almost going to do two jobs. It's going to render what you're seeing, and it's going to pick up the data of your game that you're playing to record it as well, in some cases. We're going to talk about a case right at the end where that's not the case, but the video card is such a big thing that you need to be wary of what you're buying. I would say that you shouldn't buy the most expensive video card that's on the market right now. New cards you probably don't need. Look for the middle, like if we are in April 2016 now, like we are. Look back about 4 or 5 months or so. See what cards were very good then. Find write-ups about those video cards. Find stress tests. Find that kind of thing. And do your homework. Because remember, this is a card that you're going to want to be happy with 4 or 5 years before you ditch it. And then buy that. The one website I can recommend that you do go and have a look at is Logical Increments. And what Logical Increments is, it's a great website that shows you steps between like a totally mediocre PC and a PC that will cost like several arms and several legs but will give you bang for your buck all the way through. Look for the middle of Logical Increments because that's normally a good place to start about thinking about spending money and thinking about the power of your computer. So Logical Increments, I can definitely recommend them. The other thing that's invisible is your central processing unit. This again is a fairly big topic and I'm just going to skate over it. Your graphics processing unit shows what's happening on screen at any time in the computer. Your central processing unit does all the thinking about it. So your central processing unit says, if I put a CD into the drive, the CD must be read. Or if I type on a document, these keys were pressed and I should display them. So the CPU is very, very important because without the CPU, you ain't got a computer. It does all of the heavy lifting inside of your computer. Again, newer is better. We've just come off of a wave where if you're an Intel, for example, there are three main types of Intel processor, the i3, the i5, and i7. Now, for the longest time, the i5 was the middle, and the i5 was okay. But if you had to ask me now what to buy, I'd say head for the lower and the mid-range of the i7, because that's just going to be better long-term value for money. And in fact, Intel's probably going to be doing something different this year. So newer is better, but again, don't kill yourself. Remember, you just want to be able to record your games and have it be a non-frustrating experience. So if the computer has a CPU and that does all the thinking, then the random access memory is where it puts all the short-term thoughts about what it's thinking. If you write a document right now, like I'm busy using PowerPoint to show you this particular slideshow, this is what is currently in the PC's memory right now. It's what it's remembering. If I turn off the computer and I turn it back on again, it will not remember that I showed you this particular slideshow because the PC's memory is only so short. The minute you turn the computer off, it stops thinking about these things and it removes them from memory and it never thinks of them again until you show this particular slideshow. So again, aim for the middle. It's not a case anymore where necessarily people are running 32-bit Windows or 32-bit Linux or 32-bit macOS. So you don't have to worry about the cap, because there used to be an artificial cap, especially on Windows, where you could only have 4 gigabytes of memory. That cap has mostly gone away. But you want to aim for the middle, because remember, there are three things that your computer absolutely has to be able to do if you're recording a game. It has to run the operating system. The operating system is Windows or Linux or macOS. It has to be able to comfortably run the recording software, and not in an idle state either. It must be able to run the recording software comfortably when you're playing a game, and it must be able to run the game. Now, of those three things, the game is probably going to consume the most memory, but again, it's about comfort level. Does the game look good? And the only way to get that right is to have it be running in a fairly hefty computer with a fairly decent amount of memory. Okay, so like I said, you need to think about what you're playing, because what you're playing is generally going to help you decide how much to spend. I play a lot of old adventure games. For me, I needed a very good computer because I wanted to be able to do this, but also because there are a couple of new-ish games that I play, but also because I use my computer consistently all the time. So every 5 years, I make a point of buying a whole new system from scratch, and I try and get the power balance to a point where I don't have to worry about the computer for 5 more years. The computer I'm using right now was a build from 2013. So it's still going to run me until 2018, probably, and then it'll be on its last legs and I'll have to replace it. But what you play will govern the power of your hardware, and it also govern what pieces of hardware are extras. Because remember that at this point in time, some computers, when you buy them, have built-in graphics cards. And those bottom-of-the-barrel computers with, not bottom-of-the-barrel, but reasonably bottom-tier computers with these built-in graphics cards might be able to record footage, but probably won't, so you want to hedge your bets. Okay, so the amount you spend will determine which pieces of hardware extras. Okay, things you will absolutely definitely need to record. Don't buy a computer that has built-in graphics. It won't work for you. Make sure you buy a graphics card. So you absolutely need a keyboard, a mouse, a monitor, and a chassis. The chassis is where you're going to put all the nifty stuff that goes on the inside. Those are the visible things. You're absolutely going to need a CPU, RAM. Those are the abbreviations from before, by the way. The CPU is central processing unit. RAM is random access memory. You're going to need a sound card. But remember, like I said, most boards. That's what they are. Most boards at this point have sound cards on them. And you'll be fine with those. And a video card. Again, don't kill yourself. I'm not giving you examples of things because this will date itself in 6 months. So just bear in mind that you're going to have to look at something like logical increments. Things that are nice to have and you don't really need but will eventually step up to if you play those kind of games are things like a controller. For PC, I almost always recommend buying an Xbox or knockoff controller. I have been using an Xbox 360 controller for the longest time and I find it quite comfortable. Other people may feel differently. The reason why I have the controller is for games like Shovel Knight. You could probably play it with a keyboard, I'm not gonna lie. It would be torturous though. So for those kind of games, you probably want a controller. A printer. The printer is there so that you can print your guides, or if you make notes for yourself, it's so that you can print those out. One very special hint, turn the printer off when you're recording, because you don't want it to suddenly decide to spit out paper while you're recording. Okay, now here's a very big debate in the Let's Play community. The debate is, should I buy a headset or should I buy a microphone? Headsets, I would recommend to people starting out. I've consistently used a headset, but I have my own reasons for that. We'll get back to that in a minute or two. But headsets and microphones are the major two things. I would recommend headsets to people who are just starting out because headsets are generally cheaper. Okay. They're usually also all-in-one because they'll have your headphones and your microphone on one piece of hardware, which makes it a lot cheaper because you don't have to go out and buy separate bits and pieces. The thing about headsets is that they are not great at recording the human voice. I had a great old headset which died at the end of last year, and I had to go get a new headset. The headset I'm using, I'm not too thrilled about, but the problem is that I spent a lot of money and then thought, I don't really want to take this back because this is a problem. So I'm going to live with this headset until it dies. But it's not a great headset, and I know it's not a great headset. And the reason why it's not a great headset is because the sound is fairly iffy on it. But in comparison with buying a microphone and headphones setup, it was cheap. Okay. For some people, headsets are frustrating to wear. I find that, like, for example, when we talk about headsets, there are a couple of different types of headset. There are on-ear headsets, which basically sit on your ear right around the earlobe. There are over-the-ear, which cover the entire ear. I find those the most comfortable. Most people don't really like them. They find them hard to wear. Or there are in-ear headsets, and I hate those. I can't stand them because they hurt. But you need to find what's comfortable for you if you're going to go the headset route. Just remember that they're going to be a little bit uncomfortable to wear, especially in the beginning when you're getting used to your headset. So I would recommend doing your homework for this as well. Okay, so why do I not really recommend a microphone? There's less flexibility. If you have a microphone, you have to stick it up somewhere. You have to lean into the microphone. You have to make sure that the microphone is picking up your voice at all time. You're probably going to need a muffler. It's a whole big production. But for the whole big production, you get the pro of way better sound. It's generally much nicer to listen to a microphone than it is to listen to a headset. But most good microphones are generally pretty expensive. And depending on where you live, you may not be able to get access to top tier microphones. So, you know, this is one of those cases where I have to tell you, do your homework. You have to go out, you have to experience both, and you have to think about what you want. In the beginning, I'm almost always going to recommend, while you're testing, get a headset. You're going to want a timer. Word advice, never use an on-screen timer. Why do I say that? Because an on-screen timer is distracting to your audience. So make sure it's off-screen. I used to have a great timer again, but then that timer died. So I bought a timer that I thought would work, but the timer that I have has got an annoying beep sound that when it runs down, it makes a hell of a racket, and I can't turn it off. And again, I'm just stuck with that because I bought it and then didn't want to take it back. So make sure that your timer is silent. Make sure that you can always see your timer. I usually, if I'm looking at my desk, my timer's right next to my monitor, so I can always see it. The other big piece of advice that I can recommend here is always give yourself an extra minute. If you're recording for 20 minutes, set the timer for 21 minutes. If you're recording for 30 minutes, set it for 31 minutes. Why do I say to do that? Because you don't know what's going to happen in the last minute of gameplay, and you may need an extra minute to wind down. Console recording is such a dark art, my god. I have never done console recording, and I probably never will because I'm a PC guy. But it's a dark art, and if you're involved with that, you're going to have to do a little bit more reading than I'm putting into this particular video. What you generally want to do, if you're going to do any kind of console recording, emulate, okay? Much easier than worrying about cables, and does this fit with this, and am I going to get this plugged into this, and all that stuff. The problem with emulation is that it is not legal, and I do not condone it. Okay? But it is the easiest, by far and away. If you're worried about why it's not legal, again, this is not a law lesson, this is a lesson on how to, or not even a lesson, it's some advice on how to pick up and start recording video games. I can't have that discussion with you because there's just no time, but just understand that emulation is not legal, but it is easy. So, let's say you ditch emulation and you want to go for an actual console recording. You've got your PS4, your Xbox One, or some kind of older device. How do you capture what's going on there? Well, you would buy a capture card. That's literally what they're called. Because what they do is they intercept the signal between the console and your computer, and instead of spitting the output to your TV, it will spit the output to your computer. So it's kind of like a go-between, and then you would pick that up and you would record that. Okay, so the capture card is really kind of just a go-between. You'd plug it into your console on the one end, your computer on the other end. You'd run a game on the console, the computer would pick it up. Okay. So your console is really running sort of through the capture card to your computer and then showing up on the computer, and that is what you're capturing and recording. You're gonna need like a little bit less, but not a lot less horsepower for this particular thing to work, because your GPU won't be doing almost any work at all, because all it will be doing is picking up the feed from your console. Your console will be doing all of the work. It will just be splitting the resulting output to your video card, and your video card will be recording that. So you may get away with having a cheaper video card, because you won't have to do quite so much legwork. But again, it's a dark art. I've never ever done it, and I don't ever intend to do it, so take everything I'm saying here with a giant pinch of salt. And that's it. That's all I have for you today. Most of these images came from Pixabay, which is a graphics site that I generally use for vector graphics. And you can find great graphics from them. This is not endorsed or anything by them. If you are hunting for vector graphics, they're a good site to go to. Thank you so much for watching. I've been your host, Lost Wolf. This has been a kind of a run-through of the bits and pieces you need when we're talking about hardware for recording your games. Thank you so much for watching. I shall see you all soon. Have a great evening, folks, and goodbye.